animals, from horses to parrots to bonobos, have been taught to talk in ways that feel surprisingly human and grammatical, at least to some. I'm animating a series about grammatical animals. So far, we've met animal communication's furry and feathered celebrities. Today, we see the backlash. How one horse, one chimpanzee, one conference, and the ensuing fallout tore up the prospect of training talking animals. Can animals grammar? What started out as a playful question has led me to animate my journey through all of my sources and notes and pull you into this tangled topic between animal communication and linguistics. So far, we've introduced grammaring animals and how humans tried teaching them our grammar. We used my critter profile sheets to meet several animals claimed to have been trained in the art of understanding or producing structured human language, like Hans the horse, who counted up numbers or letters with hoof taps. We then met Alex, Chaser, Kanzi, and finally Nim Chimpsky, whose teacher researchers logged him signing over 20,000 utterances, including multi-sign combinations. So if that was me asking how good was their grammar, this time it falls apart. How bad was it? 1980, in New York City. Animal communication experts convene a three-day conference. The name? The Clever Hans Phenomenon. Wait, so Hans was a phenomenon now? Not for the best of reasons. Decades earlier, at the turn of the 1900s, Hans's hooves tapped out answers to questions surrounded by an encouraging audience and a bobbing trainer. They also attracted the attention of hesitant onlookers, sure there was a trick to it. There was. I've already dropped hints. No worries if you didn't spot them. The head researcher who tried to debunk Hans didn't either. But his student kept on testing, eventually proving the horse was reading cues. The hoof language worked when the trainer asked a question, and when someone else asked a question, and when the trainer hid. And it worked when this persistent tester bent at the waist, and the hoof would stomp. And when he pulled back and the horse finished answering, lean in, stomp, head back, stop stomping. Hans had been picking up on these subtle cues. Even the tester, there to debunk the horse and trainer, found it hard not to cue Hans subconsciously. Hans's cleverness was all in his ability to read people and make associations. His trainer friend hadn't been deceitful, just genuinely and mistakenly convinced that a horse was doing more than following cues. And so throughout animal communication, this became known as the Clever Hans Effect. In 1979, the head of Project Nim called it, analyzed all the results, and turned sour. Nim's apparent sentence patterns were merely habits, nothing especially grammatical here. Unlike human children, sentence length was not growing as Nim learned more words, and even when Nim talked more, he was not adding new info, not elaborating, just repeating. There were no honest questions or complex declarative sentences in the data, no chit-chat, no curiosity about the intentions of others, just commands, wants, needs. Despite initial impressions, Nim had not been forming human-like sentences. Zooming out from the intense focus on Nim and looking at the humans in the room looking back at him, something else surfaced. Nim was cueing off the trainers surrounding him and mimicking their behavior. The project lead name-dropped the horse once more, lamenting how he'd been taken in by the Clever Hans Effect. The very next year, after this Project Nim paper, that conference would convene and in its title take Hans's name in vain once more. News of the day reports how experts got into feud-like arguments with plenty of condescension towards anyone gravitating to the claims that animals have language. It's not just Nim or Hans, it's Kanzi, it's Alex, it's dolphin experiments that, yes, did get weird, it's every talking animal. Yank the proud caretakers in lab coats from the scene, and the animal fails to be grammatical. As the jaded head of Project Nim said, These experiments were mainly products of self-deception, nothing more than clever Hans shows, animal attractions, tricks, often performed for treats. Alex's trainer herself later spills her opinions in a paper. She draws a direct line from NIM to that conference blowup and shares how in its wake, lab funding withers for talking animals. The repercussions remind another sympathetic ethologist of when in 1866, the Linguistic Society of Paris prohibited all study of language origins. Pause the criticism. When we ask, can animals grammar? What are we looking for? At this point in our story, the loudest voices underline a general consensus that no non-human animal can truly compose sentences out of words. If we hold out hope for anything approaching human grammar in animal linguistics, we'd guess it should look or sound or feel like taking smaller meaningless units, building them up into meaningful pieces, roots, affixes, morphemes, and those into words, and then putting those words together in sequences. And if those sequences are sentence-like, they'll be guided by the patterns, rules, constraints, functions of syntax. So who could we count on to go out and find this basic linguistic-like grammar thing they're saying these animals lack? Slow turn to animal enthusiasts who'd already been in the field, and the forest and the ocean, studying animal signals for decades. As the dust settles, let's meet some of the most hopeful candidates for grammaring animals I've been collecting in my Grammanimals spreadsheet, and find out if and how non-humans natively structure their own calls. We tried to teach grammar to them. Now instead, let's learn grammar from them. For the heart of this project, come study some wild grammars. Next time. Thanks for watching so far. Instead of an ad, let me again point us to groups who care for animal habitats. If you have anything left after that, join my patrons and tippers. Links to all those, along with my sources document and my Grammanimals spreadsheet below. Stick around and subscribe for more grammatical animals.